Well, hey, church, come on and stand up with us. We worship a good, amazing, powerful God full of love for his children. Amen. Come on, let's sing. Let's worship him today. Come on.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. The whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. Truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you
sing this again. Sing, worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place.
Blessed assurance,
Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit and washed in His blood. And what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior.
Lord,
That's why I trust Him. Trust in God, my Savior, will never fail. You will never fail. One more time we sing, I trust in God.
Church, would you pray with me? God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, this gift of grace, and may the cry of our heart today be that Jesus would be first, that he would be lifted high, exalted, magnified, and glorified for all to see. And today, as we approach your word, as we're in your presence, would you prepare our hearts to receive all that you have for us today? We ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen. Church, would you be seated? Jesus first, that is the theme for this season. That is the cry of our hearts. That is the anthem. If you were here last week on our Vision Sunday, you would have seen and heard all the ways that God is leading us into this new season, who we are to be as the church and what we are to do in the people and places and lives that he has placed us. One of the most tangible, one of the practical ways that we do this and we show this is with our giving. With our giving, we say, I am going to give all that I have and all that I am to join in God and his purposes. It's an act of partnership. It's also an act of praise. So to worship in this way, you can follow some of the methods listed behind me on the screen. Perhaps you've been wondering for the last couple weeks, hey, what are my next steps with this church, with Bayview Glen, with the body of Christ? Well, we're excited to announce that on October 15th, we're launching once again our discovery course. That's where you can come and learn about who we are, our mission, our vision, our values. You can also learn more about yourself. How has God gifted you? How has he wired you? How can you join us in mission and partnership together as his people? So also to sign up for this, it's listed behind us. You can do so on our website. Finally, one of the things that we've been given by God as his people is peace. We have peace with God, and it's not only for us, but it's given that it might be given through us to all others. So whenever the church gathers for thousands of years, she has taken time to pass the peace with one another. And so we're going to do that today. If you're watching and joining online, worshiping with us, I would invite you to just put in the chat, may the grace and peace of Jesus Christ be with you. And for us today, in a moment, I'm going to invite you to stand. And would you turn and greet one or two people that you may not know? Meet them for the first time this morning. Pass the peace of Christ to be with them. So would you stand and let's pass the peace of Christ together today.
Today's first reading is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in the sanctification of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you.
Amen. Thank you, Josiah. May God's grace and peace be multiplied to you. We shared that greeting. We're going to talk about that. As many of you know, for 13 years, my family and I, we lived in Missouri. And sometimes people asked, what was it like for a Canadian to live in Missouri? What's it like? And there are some things you have to get used to not having. No ketchup chips. No all-dress chips, no Swiss chalet, No Mars bars, no Coffee Crisp. I mean, there's certain things you had to learn to really sacrifice and do without. There were certain things that we had to learn to say differently. And saying, I want a pop, you had to say, I want a soda. And it was kind of odd seeing my kids when they were 4 or 5 say, hey, Dad, can I have a soda? Just didn't roll off the tongue in the same way. There's some benefits. We got to have 2 Thanksgivings. We'd have a Canadian Thanksgiving and a U.S. Thanksgiving. But let me ask you, what is it like to be a follower of Jesus in the GTA? What's it like to be a citizen of heaven in Canada? It really is a very similar question. Because sometimes as a follower of Jesus, we don't always fit, or we don't feel that we fit, or we don't feel that the world is kind of open to us. And if you are a teenager who's really trying to follow Jesus, sometimes you may find it difficult in your school system. If you are a worker who's really trying to work as unto the Lord and do your best, you may find that you don't always fit in our culture. If you're a person who's trying to live ethically and honestly and not lie or steal or kind of take things or skim things off the top, you may feel that you don't quite fit. And so sometimes what happens when we don't feel like we can kind of fit in our culture is that we do one of 2 things. Sometimes what we do is we say, well, I'm going to follow Jesus, but I'm going to accommodate to the culture. I'm going to live like the culture says. I'm just going to try to blend in and do what the culture does and hope that maybe God understands. Or we do a second thing, is that we isolate from the culture. We kind of wall ourselves in. We have our nice little Christian kind of enclave, and maybe we get mad at the world and we rail at things. But what we notice in Scripture is that Jesus, he never accommodated to the culture, but he didn't isolate himself. That the early church, the apostles, they didn't accommodate themselves to the culture, nor did they isolate themselves. That they found a way to be able to thrive and live well within a culture that was maybe somewhat hostile to what they believed or what they had. And for the next couple months, we're going to look at a book in the Bible that I think was written to help you and I understand what it's like to live in this culture. And what it's like when we may not feel quite comfortable here. So if you have your Bibles or your mobile devices, I invite you to look at 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to go verse by verse through 1 Peter over the next 10 weeks or so. And understand this book. Peter writes to people and talks about their spiritual life, understand who God is. He's going to talk to them about how to live practically in this world. And then the last part of the book, the last third, is really how to deal with suffering when life crumbles. And Peter today, as he introduces this book, the first couple verses, he's going to encourage us to understand our identity, who we are. Because it's out of our identity that we make everyday decisions. And in verse 1, he's going to talk about our identity with culture and the world. Do we understand our relationship and how we identify with the culture? And in verse 2, he's going to talk about our identity as children of God with him. And so the first thing Paul wants to remind us is that when Jesus is first and we understand our identity, we understand our world better and we understand how to relate in the world. Paul says this in Peter says, verse 1, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. And so Peter here, oh, good grief. I mean, good. And this is live. This is what I wish. I know some of you, you've got a game. How many times is it going to mess up and say, Peter, you're going to write it down and go, Pastor, you messed up like 47 times. Peter is the author of this book, and he's writing to people who are scattered. And we're going to look at that in a moment. This is known in the New Testament as a general epistle. There are Paul's kind of more specific epistles who are written to certain churches. Peter and John wrote what we call a general epistle that is written to a wide group of people. This group of people is in modern-day Turkey. He's writing to those who are scattered, who are Jewish believers and who are Gentile believers in Turkey. And it's written about 42, 43 AD. It's written just a decade or so after Jesus went to the cross. And it's written just before the great persecution in the Roman Empire of Christians through Nero. In 43, 44 AD, a year or two after this, Rome burned. You remember that Nero blamed the Christians. It wasn't the Christians' fault, but the Christians were fed to lions. They were put on posts and lit a fire. They had to fight in the gladiator stadium. And this is just a year before, and there was a brewing animosity towards Christians. And many of them had lost their jobs. Many of them were finding themselves impoverished. Many of them were excommunicated from their families. And Peter here is writing to encourage them. And the author here is Peter. And this would be an honor for them to get this letter, because Peter at the time was perceived as the leader of the church. Paul was the main apostle, but Peter was seen as the head of the church. And I think we all like Peter. We may admire Paul, but I think we get Peter. Right? Paul is TVO, and Peter is City TV. Right? Paul is kind of PBS, and Peter is Sportsnet. I mean, he's a guy's guy. And Peter is the one who talks the most of the apostles throughout the Gospels. So he's the one Jesus rebukes the most. He's the one that's always out there. When he sees Jesus walking on water, he's like, I can do that, and he goes out to meet him. Peter was always the one who thought he could do something. And so the night before Jesus was crucified on the cross, he goes to Jesus and he says, hey, Jesus, I'm going to defend you. I'm going to follow you everywhere. And of course, Jesus says, no, before the morning comes, you're going to even deny me three times, not just once, but three times. And of course, Peter denies knowing Jesus. He doesn't seem anywhere found when the crucifixion happens. And he begins to wonder, how do you recover from that? And I think we get Peter because we all understand him, that we've made messes in our life and that we've gone through things and we think, this is unrecoverable. I don't know how to make it through. And Jesus, shortly after his resurrection, has breakfast with Peter and the other disciples on the beach. And he says, hey, Peter, I know what you've done, but I know what you can do. And Peter was chosen and loved and called by Jesus. Jesus chooses Peter again to be his apostle and disciple and to bring the gospel to the world. And so 50 days after the resurrection and Pentecost comes and the Holy Spirit's there, Peter's the one who gets up in front of thousands of people and shares who Jesus is. Peter and John are going to the temple one day, and they see a man who is lame since birth, and they heal him, and he gets up, and he walks, and he does these amazing things, and yet right after that, he's put in prison. And Peter here understands that when we serve Jesus, and Jesus is first, we may be admired by some, but persecuted by others. And this is going to be a theme that Peter weaves throughout this letter. That part of living with Jesus first is that we're going to do things that people admire and that others can't tolerate. Peter lives his life. he expands the church. He ends up in prison again. He's going to be killed for his faith. His fate is going to be crucifixion. And tradition says he didn't think himself worthy to be crucified in the same way of Jesus, so he has to be crucified upside down. And so when Peter, at the end of this letter, is going to write to people who are suffering and isolated, they're going to understand Peter knows what they are going through. And Peter writes to people and he says, here is your identity. He calls them elect exiles. He says that you are elect chosen exiles. Now, the word here, exile, in our understanding today, usually has a very negative meaning. An exile is often a political prisoner who's sent somewhere or can't go to his own country. We think of maybe Roman Polanski, who's living in Europe because he comes back to North America, he'll be charged with things, or Julian Assange from WikiLeaks, who's hiding in a prison in London, worried that he'll come back to the U.S. to be extradited and charged for crimes there. We think of an exile as someone who's alone and isolated. That's not what the meaning of this word is. Exile is probably better understood as like a resident alien, a permanent resident holder. It refers to someone who's moved to a different country other than their own, but who's living and working there. They're enjoying the life there, settling in there, but it's not their homeland. And they're not citizens there. And so I think Peter uses this term because it describes who we are, that we, once we give ourselves to Jesus, we become citizens of heaven. We move from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. We are citizens of heaven, but we're still now living in this world. This world is not our home. It's not our destiny. It's not where we're going to be there, but we have to live in this world and understand it. And so when Paul uses this term, exiles or resident aliens, he's referring to several things. One is that this is not our home. We shouldn't get too comfortable here. Right? Our home is really in heaven. We're citizens of heaven. We're living as if we are in heaven. And so sometimes we wonder, you know, why is it that this world, it just doesn't feel right? Right. A number of years ago, my wife and I, we spent 2 months visiting missionaries around the world, and they put us in their home. We were in some very nice hotels. We were living very well. People tried to give us good food, tried to make us feel at home. But after being gone for 2 months, the first night we got back in our bed, you know, and you felt all the right lumps in the right places, you're like, oh, this is home. This is home. And sometimes we try desperately to make this world our home, and it isn't. And I would say for the last 100 years or so, people in our world, we try to put heaven on earth. We try to make earth as much like heaven, and it's not. This is not home. And sometimes we spend our life, well, I'm going to try another job. I'm going to marry another person. I'm going to move to a different location because we hope that, well, maybe we'll feel better there. Maybe we'll feel more comfortable there or settled there. We will never, as followers of Jesus, feel settled here. And maybe you're here today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus, and maybe this isn't quite making sense, but this makes sense, that you just don't quite feel at home. And you think, I'm looking for something, that there's something in this world. And maybe you're searching for something. You're thinking, maybe if I just choose this job or go to this place or be with this person or go somewhere and try to find myself, I'll try to be home. We're not meant for this world. And Jesus invites you to come and be a citizen of heaven in his life. Secondly, it means we should not become comfortable here. We should not do what we can to be comfortable. And sometimes someone described like what it is to live as a resident alien here in this world is like, that we're trying to make our home in a furniture store. Right? A furniture store has all the trappings of home. It has everything you need. It has beds, couches. It has tables, chairs. It has appliances. It's got everything you need. Trying to make a home there, but it won't be home. We'll never be comfortable here. And we shouldn't be comfortable here. Now, what's happened, though, is particularly some of us who are a bit older, 40, 50, 60 years ago, the morals of North America were very similar to Christian morals and values. Right? The values of society and the values when it came to life and the values of the church and the values of personhood and the values of community and being together and doing life together, they were very much very similar to the moral values of our country. And then the sexual revolution of the 60s hit, and then media changed things, and now we have social media where you can become who you want and say what you want, and all of a sudden, we don't feel very comfortable here. And a lot of times people say, oh, I wish I could go back to the good old days. I wish I could go back to the way it was, like the 1940s or the 1950s. I wish we could go back to life like that. But that's really a lie. Because what we want is we want to go back to the values of, say, 1940, 1950, but we don't want to go back to the Christian life because the Christian life is still opposed. And people in the 1940s may have had the values, of Christianity and Judaism, but they did not have the life. They were not seeking Jesus. They were not putting Jesus first. They were not living on mission for him. They were not living, as we're going to see, in a delightful life, but also under the same challenges of coming up against a culture. And I think sometimes we have to be careful of saying, oh, I wish we could just go back to the good old days. The good old days, people were not always living Jesus first. And we don't understand what it is, Paul says, or Peter says, to live as an exile here in this world. And thirdly, when Paul says, or Peter says that we are an exile, he means that we should understand that we are going to be in trouble for our faith at times, that we're not going to be valued and respected. We're not going to be understood. And people are not going to understand us. Now, many people on their list, I know Christmas is coming, it's a few months away, but on their Christmas list, sometimes people's favorite Christmas movie is Elf. Right? Anybody like Elf? Anybody Elf? Some of you, yeah, there's a few shout-outs for Elf. Elf is the story of someone who is born in America, and then he's taken to the North Pole. And he's raised by Santa. So he's got a whole new place. And then he comes back and he tries what? To live in New York. But he's living really as an exile. He's living, right, as a permanent resident. His citizenship and his mindset really is from the North Pole. But he's living in New York. And how is he received? Not well. Because people don't put syrup on their spaghetti. And he believes what? He knows the big guy. He knows Santa. And he's trying to tell people about him. And not everyone wants to believe. And he talks about faith. And he talks about having enough faith. And what that happens. And what's the result? They isolate him. They get rid of him. They try to do away with him. We don't want you in our life. They're intrigued by him. And sometimes, maybe even a little bit inspired by the naivety that he has. But they don't want him around. And this was Peter. Right? This is Peter's understanding of what it is to be a citizen of heaven in our culture. That Peter, right, heals a man A person that everybody walked by for decades, Peter heals him, he's walking, and what happens to Peter? He's put in prison. He's disturbing the peace. And that this is part of what it is to be in exile, to understand that we live in a different way, in a way that's intriguing to people and maybe inspiring to some, but not everyone is going to value it. And yet somehow we're still surprised. Just like Elf was surprised when people didn't understand everything. Peter says here, we are exiles. This is our identity. We shouldn't be too comfortable because we have a different citizenship. And secondly, he says that we're scattered. He writes to exiles who are scattered, people who are placed. The Greek word that's used here is the word diaspora. It means a scattering. It's the same thing a farmer would do to scatter seed to plant crops. And Peter here says, I'm writing to you Christians who are scattered, your resident aliens who are scattered all throughout this area of Turkey. Now, when people would hear that word diaspora, they would understand it in a particular way because the Jewish people have been scattered 500 years before. And there was a point in Israel's history around 5-600 BC where Israel had been split into two kingdoms. Both kingdoms were rejecting God and pushing God away and not living that way. And God says, if you keep doing that, I'm going to bring another nation in who's going to take you as political prisoners. And you're going to be scattered, not in Israel anymore, but you're going to be scattered in Assyria and Babylon and eventually then Persia. And that's what happened. Israel just said, we want to do it our own way. Assyria and then Babylon comes in, takes these people political prisoners, and they become the diaspora, the people who are scattered. Now, in one sense, this was kind of punishment in a sense, or discipline is probably a better word, to help them see, hey, it's a better way to put God first. But when they were being scattered, Jeremiah said, there's a way that you're to live. You're going as permanent residents or exiles into another nation. How are you to live? Are you to accommodate yourself to the culture? Or are you to isolate? And Jeremiah says, no, there's a better way. In Jeremiah 29, verse 4, it says, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I've sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce, take wives, have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons, give your daughters in marriage, that you may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there, do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city for where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find welfare. In its blessing you will be blessed. And so Jeremiah says to the exiles, he says, when you go and you're scattered and you're really planted in other areas, I want you to live well. I want you to live in such an admirable way that you bring blessing to the city. I want you, basically what Jeremiah is saying, is to show them what it's like when you live God first. When you put God first, that it's the most brilliant way to live and it's attractive to them, although they will not understand it always and they will still persecute you. And we see some of the exiles did that. Daniel is the classic example. Daniel is a 13-year-old, goes from Israel into Babylon, and he says, hey, wait, there's a better way to live. There's a better diet to live. Prayer is a way of living. Worshiping God is a way of living. Listening to God, discerning what he does, it's the best way. And there were people in Babylon who applauded Daniel and said, what a great guy you are. And then there were others who threw him in a lion's den. And so, friends, sometimes we wonder, how do I know? How do I know that I'm living Jesus first, what God wants? Because Peter here, I think, is the same. Live Jesus first. You live as an exile in this society and culture in an admirable way that points people to the beauty of God in his life, but you will also be persecuted. And when you're doing things that people admire, and yet others don't get it because of your faith, you're probably walking that balance. And Peter here says, you live as resident aliens in this culture because you're citizens of the kingdom of heaven, scattered and planted. You're planted where you are, in your school, in your workplace, in your neighborhood, to live Jesus first so that others will see the beauty of that, even if they don't agree. First thing Peter says here, verse 1, is understand your identity, because it's out of our identity we make our everyday living. Our identity within our culture is that we're exiles. Secondly, he says, I want you to understand your identity with God, that you are loved, that you are fully loved. He says, remember in verse 1 that you are elect exiles, and in verse 2, he says, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ, and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. He says in verse 1, you are elect exiles. Now, this in some ways is kind of a contradiction in term. Exiles, in a sense, is scattered people. Maybe people who are disregarded, in some way people that the culture might look as rejects, but he said, you are chosen. In verse 1, he says, you are chosen rejects, but you're chosen. The world may see you as exiles, not quite belonging, but God sees you as chosen. And we see in the second verse four quick things that God says about our identity with him. And from our culture, we're exiles. From our world, we are chosen. First of all, we are wholly loved by God. We are loved by him. It's what the word elect, chosen. I mean, it refers to the fact that we are loved by him. Do you know what it's like when you were a kid or you're chosen for a team? And everybody wanted what? Everyone wanted to be chosen first. No one wanted to be chosen last. Why? Because to be chosen, it shows you're valued. You're loved. You're appreciated. You've given something. And Peter here says that God has elected us. He's chosen us. Now, from a theological perspective, this often gets rather complicated, and people have been divided over the years in church. What does it mean? Sometimes people say, oh, God chose us according to his foreknowledge, that he looked down the corridors of time, and he tried to see, did we choose him? So he chooses us kind of before we chose him. Other people say, no, God chooses us. We have no choice in the matter. That God just chooses. He chooses some to be with him and some who won't be with him. And I think we fail to look at this like we look at many other things in Scripture, that this, God's election, God's choosing, it's an antimony. It's two opposites that almost somehow go together. It's like God is one, but he's a trinity in three in one. It's a mystery. That Jesus is fully human, fully divine. You're human or you're divine? It's a mystery. That God chooses us. And I think what Peter wants to remind us is that we're loved, we're chosen, and that somehow our free will and our ability to choose, it gets woven in there. But God loves us. He's chosen us. Not because of who we are or how good we are, right? Sometimes that's where they, oh, God chose me, or God chooses people because they're good or they're better or they're different. When God talked about choosing Israel, the nation as a people, he says in Deuteronomy 7, verse 6, he says, for you are a people holy to the Lord your God, and the Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession. I chose you because I loved. Out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth, But it's not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord set his love on you and chose you, for you were the fewest of all people. But verse 8, but it is because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to you and swore to your fathers. And Moses here in Deuteronomy, he equates God's election or choosing what with his love. Not because of who we are or we've got anything really lovable in us, but he loves us. And Peter here says, to people who feel that they don't belong, aren't very comfortable living in the world, he says, but you are also chosen. Understand who God, how God sees you. You're chosen. When you go to work, when you go to school, when you make a business deal, when you're talking with your neighbor, you're chosen. Secondly, Peter says, we're also known. We are completely known by God. We're known by him. Right? Peter says in verse 2 here, according to the foreknowledge of God, that God knows us, that he's always known us. Psalm 139 says, before we were born, while we were in our mom's womb, God knows us. Now, we struggle because knowledge for us is something that we acquire and have over time, and then something we forget, right? Oh, yeah, I knew that, but I forgot. Oh, yeah, I knew that, but I forgot. God knows, and it's not acquired, nor does he forget. And so you are chosen, and God knows you. And sometime this week, you're going to wonder, does God really know this is going on in my life? Does God see? Does God understand? God knows us. In fact, he knows us, and he says we're also constantly growing. We're loved, we're known, but we're growing. In verse 2, Peter here says that we, right, are being changed by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is working in us, sanctifying us, changing us, helping us become like him. And because God has chosen us and he knows our life, the things in our life are helping us to grow and become like him. And sometimes we don't see that, right? We don't always see the growth in ourselves. Sometimes we need other people. And that's why sometimes we encourage people to get into a life group, get into a group, be part of a community of people who can pray you through what it's like to live as a resident alien in this culture and who can remind you, hey, God has chosen you. He loves you. He values you. And if you're not part of a life group, I encourage you in the next few weeks, sign up for our life group launch or event. Get to be with a few people who can just help. Our group is, we said this week, we really want to just grow in prayer. We want to be a laboratory where we understand how we grow more in prayer in this world. How do we do that? And you may not see it, but the Holy Spirit is changing you. And so see that as your identity. You're chosen by God, loved by God, known by God, changed by God, and you're increasingly being blessed by God. Paul ends this greeting, this first two verses are really his greeting, with grace and peace to you. Grace and peace multiply to you. We are increasingly being blessed by God. And Peter here uses a combination of a Hebrew greeting and a Greek greeting. The Hebrew greeting was shalom. The Jewish people would say shalom when they met someone. Shalom, it means peace. And really, it's the sense of may life be as it should be. That's peace. Peace is when life is as it really should be. May everything be well with you. And he took the Greek greeting, peace, or grace. And grace is the idea of something that's beautiful, delightful. May the most delightful, good things happen to you. And Peter here joins them together. And it became the Christian greeting, grace and peace, because you really can't have peace without grace. You can't have fully the peace of God without the grace of God. And some of you, you're here today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus and you're wondering why don't I feel at peace? Why don't I feel comfortable? I'm looking for things. It's because there is no peace without the grace of God. And this is what Peter says in verse 2. It's for obedience to Jesus and through the sprinkling of his blood, what Jesus has done for us. And friends, we want to live a Jesus first life. What is it that Jesus is first as a resident alien? Jesus is first in understanding our identity with him. And in the lobby, there's some posters and the markers. And throughout this series, we just want to challenge you, write something there. You don't have to sign it or put your name, but just write something there that's your commitment to Jesus first. How am I going to live Jesus first? But the night before he died, Jesus wanted us to experience shalom and peace. And he took a cup and he said, this is the blood, symbol of my blood going to be shed. And he broke bread. He said, this is my body broken for you. And this is what Jesus did for us. And in a moment after we sing, we're going to take those elements. But I invite you, as you hold the bread in the cup, is Jesus first? Are you living Jesus first in this world and living Jesus first in your relationship with him?
Amen, church. Let's come to the Lord's table together now. The night before he was to be crucified, Christ said to his disciples, as often as you gather, when you eat or drink, do this in remembrance of me, that we remember the great price that was paid for us, a called people. And so when we take this and we eat this, we're remembering and we're proclaiming that the person and work of Jesus Christ is just as real and just as near as the bread and the cup. So let's take this together. First, the bread, symbolizing the body of Christ that was broken for you. Let's take this together in remembrance of him. And now let's partake of the cup, which represents the blood of Christ that was poured out for you. Let's take this in remembrance of him. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ is coming again. Amen. As we conclude our time of worship together, I just want to remind you that our prayer partners will be up here at the front. If there's something that we can join you in prayer together for, we would encourage you to come. They're here to partner with us in this way. Have a great week, church. Take care. Bye.